50 years ago, the Marshall University football team was playing a road game against the East Carolina Pirates down in Greenville, North Carolina. Marshall University football team would suffer a loss that game 17-14 and would travel back to Huntington, West Virginia through the air on a plane. Sadly, that flight would never reach its destination back home, crashing short in a field.
A rim of splintered trees on a hill close to Huntington's Tri-State Airport shows where the DC-9 carrying the Marshall University football team and others scraped yesterday before piling into the next hill. Special FBI agents are working over the charred remains of the planes, 75 passengers and crew. At least 46 of the bodies are those of Marshall football players and coaches.
The crash killed 75 members on board, including players, coaches, teammates, staff, and personnel, and fans included.
The crash devastated the city of Huntington and the state of West Virginia for many years after that devastating crash on November 14, 1970, and is still recognized today as one of the deadliest sports tragedies in American history. Marshall University chooses each year to honor those 75 victims with a memorial fountain ceremony held around the memorial fountain outside the Student Center that honors those 75 victims. This year, though, is different due to the COVID-19 pandemic that has changed all of our lives. Marshall needed to figure out how to honor those 75 victims, but keep everyone safe at the same time and prevent the spread of COVID-19. And they did just that this year with the 50th memorial fountain ceremony.
You could be the person who was here in the wake of the crash to help rebuild the football program and heal the heartbreak around the town and surrounding areas. You could be a former football player who came here to be a part of the program in the 70s, 80s, 90s, or 2000s. You could be a son or a daughter of Marshall, or a son or a daughter of someone who passed away in the crash. You're here to help carry on the legacy of the 75. Everyone knows someone profoundly affected by the crash. We're all connected by this event forever. That's what makes Marshall University, our football program in this town, unlike any other in the country. We remember a tragedy that occurred 50 years ago today. We carry on our legacy, and we do it as a tight-knit community that leans on each other. Arm in arm, together.
Like I said, I'm a West Virginia native. I was a teenager living more than an hour away, looking at the Marshall Airport when the plane crashed 50 years ago. My father lost friends, my father lost players, my father lost coaches who had worked for him, players who had played for him. He was a high school coach. My father's 86 years old, and I've seen him cry one time when he got the call that plane had crashed into the mountain coming back from East Carolina. A few years later, I was fortunate enough to be able to attend Marshall University and play football. The emotional wounds were still fresh then, and in some ways, they still are. But once you become a son or daughter of Marshall, you feel a connection to this place that is like any other.
Loved and heard, one and all, much like this community and all involved. It's about the 75 which we always remember. Parents, sons, daughters, and friends we lost that November. We too love the herd with all our hearts, and we cheer on the ones that now play their parts. It was a challenging time, sadness but no pity, and the sun still shines on this university and city. Coaches, players, fans, and crew will be remembered forever. To honor the 75 is what brings us together. You know you're with friends when you hear, "Go Herd, we are Marshall." It's a feeling like no other, hearing shouts from afar. We are all connected by what happened that day. We are so grateful.
As you just saw, those were some of the clips captured at the ceremony this year. Marshall University did what needed to be done to honor the 75 and prevent the spread of COVID-19. Chairs were spread out 6 feet apart, and each guest and speaker was required to wear a mask. In the next clip, I got to talk with the president of Marshall University, Dr. Jerome Gilbert, and ask him about the ceremony and the behind the scenes on the precautions that they had to take to keep the ceremony going.
You know, we are not as restrictive outside as we are inside, but we still needed to take precautions so that we didn't end up with a super spreader. And we were afraid that if we didn't take very deliberate steps to keep people separated outside, that we could have people gathering together either unintentionally or innocently and spreading the disease. So we decided that we would have to space all the chairs on the fountain area, which is right out here along the plaza. So we put a good 6 feet or more between the chairs, which meant that we couldn't get very many people on the fountain. So then we looked at Buskirk Field and the west side over here. We put chairs out there as well. And then we knew that in years past that people congregated all around. So we decided that we needed to rope off the area. So we actually put in barriers and ropes, and we had security forces in place to keep people, you know, I didn't think they would violate that, but if there wasn't someone there to remind them that they couldn't go in without invitation, we knew that many people would just come in. So we put security forces out, we had check-ins so that people were issued invitations, all of the family members were issued invitations. It was invitation and RSVP. We invited a lot of dignitaries as well. So then it was just managing the crowd to make sure that we didn't have too many people too close together. We also had to not have the choir singing because we felt like that would be a potential spread because of all the voices. Even though they would be somewhat separated, we still felt like that was going to be a challenge or a danger. So we pre-recorded all of that. We couldn't have the coach up here because the coach had been tested and couldn't get exposed because he was going to be on the field with the players. We didn't want him, so he had to pre-record. We actually pre-recorded all of the speeches in case something were to go wrong and we would have to switch to all virtual. So we had done all that preparation. So there were a lot of steps that we put in place to make sure that we had the proper precautions so we didn't spread COVID unnecessarily or inadvertently. Well, we decided that we would grant the posthumous degrees to those students. I had asked the question a year before when we started talking about the ceremony or the fountain ceremony about posthumous degrees and had we awarded those. And when I found out that we hadn't, I decided that, you know, that was something that we wanted to consider doing. So we made those plans and invited the family, and it was very gratifying to me to be able to do that for the families. I think many of them had come to closure, but this was just one little added extra closure. And I saw a couple articles about how proud the families were to have their loved one's degree now, that they had not had that before. So I felt like it was sort of a great gesture, something we needed to do, we probably should have done before. It turned out this was a great time to do it on the 50th anniversary because all of the families were going to be here. So it felt very, very, very good to be able to do that for those families. Well, you know, certainly we each year we think about the 75 and we reflect on their passing, but this year we had a very special addition, and that is we had these banners that are around the plaza, which is one for each of the 75 on the plane. And I took time to go and look at all of the different banners, some more so than others in terms of the amount of time that I spent, because I knew some of these individuals' descendants and relatives, and it was a very powerful thing to be able to go and reflect on the image of the person and think about them back in 1970. So it was a very, very solemn and very meaningful thing for me to be able to go around to the banners and stop and reflect on each one.
As President Gilbert stated in his interview, Marshall hung banners around the interior of the campus that showed the faces of each victim that perished in the crash 50 years ago. Each banner shows who the person was, whether they were a player, coach, staff member, or a simple fan. COVID-19 has affected all of our lives this year, but COVID did not stop Marshall from honoring the 75. In fact, it didn't stop others as well. For example, down in Atlanta, Georgia, at the College Football Hall of Fame, they had a display at the front of the building to honor the 75 this year. No matter what bad occurs in the world, whether it be a pandemic or anything else bad, we will always honor the 75. Those that were lost in the tragedy will never be forgotten, and they have helped us become who we are. We are Marshall.